In this video, we'll go over the setup process for a SwiftOne acoustic recorder. To perform the setup, you'll need a SwiftOne recorder, a micro USB cable, and a Windows compatible PC.
Okay, so the first thing you want to do is get the SwiftOne configuration utility running. After the installation is finished, you will find the utility in the Windows Start menu under the Center for Conservation Bioacoustics folder. So we'll scroll down to the C section in the Start menu, look for Center for Conservation Bioacoustics, and inside you'll find SwiftOne Configuration Utility. You can choose to right-click on it and select Pin to Start to pin a shortcut to the Start menu to make it easier to find in the future, like I just did.
Once you have the configuration utility running, you can connect the SwiftOne recorder via the USB cable. You'll need to remove the lid and locate the USB connector near the front of the enclosure. You'll hear the Windows chime indicating that a new USB device has been detected, and the blue standby LED at the front of the enclosure will turn solid blue. You'll also notice that the SwiftOne configuration utility now displays the configuration settings summary screen.
This screen gives you an overview of how all the SwiftOne settings are currently configured. You can't change any of the settings from this screen, but it gives you a quick overview of how your Swift is currently programmed. To change the settings, you need to click through the tabs on the left. We'll visit each tab starting with the Date and Time tab. To set the internal date and time on the Swift recorder, you can either click Sync Time to Computer button or manually set the date and time to the menus below, and then clicking the Update button. For now, we'll click the Sync Time to Computer button to sync the time on the Swift with the time on your computer. Setting the correct date and time is very important because all the recorded audio files will be timestamped. This way you'll know when a particular wildlife call has occurred. Also, the scheduled settings rely on the internal date and time, and date and time settings need to be accurate for the scheduling to work correctly. We'll cover the scheduling settings in a bit. Moving on to the File Options tab, this is where you can configure settings pertaining to the recorded audio files. The first setting option allows you to set a custom file name prefix. This prefix will be appended to the beginning of every audio file. The custom prefix can be a maximum of 8 characters long. In this example, I'll change it to test1. The label below gives a preview of the full audio file name. The name contains the custom prefix, the year, month, day, and hour, minute, and seconds, .wav. You must click the Save Changes to Swift button before the new prefix takes effect. The next setting allows you to change the maximum audio recording file size. This setting allows you to break the recording up into more manageable chunks. Moving the slider allows you to select different audio file maximum size limits, ranging from 57 megabytes to 1,382 megabytes. The length of each audio file in minutes is also displayed. For example, if I choose 230 megabytes per file, that file will contain 1 hour of audio at the selected sample rate of 32 kilohertz. We'll discuss the sample rate options in a moment. Again, you have to click the Save Changes to Swift button before the changes will take effect. Next, we'll visit the Gain and Sample Rate tab. The gain setting boosts the signal strength from the microphone to higher levels or reduces it to lower levels. You can change the gain level using the slider, and it can be adjusted from 0 decibels up to 47.5 decibels in 0.5 decibel steps. To start with, we recommend using the default value of 28 dB. Next is the audio sample rate settings. The sample rate determines the highest audio frequencies that can be captured by the recorder. You have a number of sample rates to choose from, ranging from 8 kHz up to 96 kHz. The higher the sample rate you choose, the more power the Swift will draw from the batteries, and your SD card will fill up faster as well. We'll leave the sample rate at the 32 kHz default setting for now, but you can change it to a different value if you'd like. Now we'll move on to the Scheduling tab. You have three different scheduling modes to choose from. These modes include arbitrary time scheduling, duty cycle scheduling, and continuous recording scheduling. You can switch between the different modes by selecting the tabs near the top of the screen. The first and most basic is the continuous recording option. For this mode, you can simply select a start date and an end date, and the recorder will record continuously between those two dates. For example, today is November 5th, 2021, so we'll select that as a start date, and we'll select an end date of December 29th, 2021. The label below states the behavior of the scheduling setting. Again, you have to click the Save Changes to Swift button to commit the scheduling changes we just made. Duty cycle scheduling allows you to set up a simple rule that will record, for example, 10 minutes every 1 hour. You can change the rule to whatever you want. For example, you could select record for 15 minutes every 1 hour 30 minutes. Or you could select record for 1 hour 20 minutes every 2 hours. Or 1 hour 20 minutes every 3 hours or 4 hours. 4 hours is the maximum you can go. Once again, you must choose a start date and an end date, and you must click the Save Changes to Swift button before the changes are committed. The labels below state the recording rule in plain English, and also tells you the number of record periods per day. The audio of each record period will be saved in a separate file on the SD card. Then the times of each record period are also written out down here. Last, we have arbitrary time scheduling. This scheduling mode allows the user to build up a table of customized daily record periods. Again, the first thing you'll want to do is set the start date and the end date. The schedule does not activate until the start date is reached. You can set a start date to a future date, in which case the scheduled recording won't occur until the future date is reached. Or you can set the start date to a date in the past, in which case the scheduled recordings will start immediately. For this example, I'll choose today, which is November 4th, 2021. Next, choose an end date. The scheduled recordings will end when the end date is reached. You always want to choose an end date that is in the future. If you choose an end date that's in the past, then your scheduled recordings will never occur. So pay close attention when setting the end date. You can choose an end date that is far into the future as you'd like. I'll choose an end date that is November 25th, 2021. The next step is to add record time periods to the scheduling table. As an example, we'll program the Swift to record for 2 hours in the morning and 2 hours in the evening. Our first record period will start at 8 a.m., so enter 08 in the start time, and end at 10 a.m., so we'll enter 10 in the stop time. Next, click at the Add to Schedule button. You'll notice that the period is added to the schedule table. The table represents one 24-hour day and always starts at midnight. In our case, the recorder will remain in the passive standby state from midnight until 8 a.m., Then it will record from 8 a.m. to 10 a.m., after which it will return to the standby state from 10 a.m. until the end of the day. Let's add a second record period now. We'll choose another start time of 2000 hours or 8 p.m., so I'll enter 20 here, and a stop time of 2200 hours or 10 p.m., so I'll enter 22 here. Once again, click the Add to Schedule button to add the second time period to the schedule table. Now we have two record times added to the schedule table. The recorder will cycle through the schedule table every day between the start date and the end date. You can continue to add additional record periods to the table with a maximum of 20 record time entries allowed. Let's add a third record period now, starting at noon and ending at 1600 hours or 4 p.m. So we'll enter 12 in the start time. And notice this red note here. It says recording duration. The recording duration overlaps with existing recording times. You cannot add a record period to the table that overlaps with an existing recording period. To correct this issue, adjust the start and or stop time to a value that does not overlap. So in our case, we want to record from noon to 4 p.m. or 1600 hours. And now we do not overlap with an existing record period, and the red warning label disappears. Once again, click Add Schedule to Table. Note that you can delete an entry from the table by clicking to select the recording period and then clicking the Delete Entry button. You can't select a standby period in the table because these are generated automatically. You can quickly clear the entire table by clicking the Clear Table button. Now that everything is configured, don't forget to click the Save Changes to Swift button once again to commit the new settings to the internal Swift Recorder memory. For the last step, go back to the Settings Summary screen and quickly scan through the table to make one last verification that everything is set the way you want it. Again, the Settings Summary screen always displays the settings that are committed to the internal Swift memory. So what you see here is what you'll get when you deploy the recorder. Start by double checking the date and time. Then you can check the battery voltage. The three D cells must be in the recorder, and the main power on-off switch near the back of the recorder must be switched to the on position. I'll switch the unit on now, and you can see the battery voltage rise up to 4.7 volts. Your battery voltage should read somewhere between 3 volts and 4.8 volts. If the voltage is down near 3 volts, then the battery should be replaced. Now, quickly check the remaining settings.
Once you are satisfied with the configuration, you can unplug the SwiftOne from the USB connection. When you do so, you'll notice that the connection is lost in the configuration utility.
Now the recorder is almost ready to deploy. All the settings we just programmed in are stored in flash memory, so they are retained even if the power is switched off or the batteries are removed. The clock has a backup coin cell battery that keeps the clock and calendar running when the power from the D cells is not available. If the SwiftOne is powered on without an SD card present, the red LED flashes to indicate an error. When we insert an SD card, the Swift checks the scheduled record start date, end date, and scheduled times to determine whether it should record or go into standby. The recorder has a start date of today, but the current time does not yet coincide with one of the record durations we programmed in under the scheduling settings. Therefore, the recorder goes directly into the passive standby state. It will remain in standby until the time of day coincides with one of the scheduled record periods. I have a second recorder that has been programmed with a scheduled record time that does coincide with the current time of day. This recorder already has an SD card in the slot, so all we have to do is power the unit on, and when we do, it will begin checking the start date, the stop date, and the record times immediately. Based on the schedule and the current time of day, it has discovered that it should be recording now. We see it goes directly into record mode as indicated by the green flashing LED. Note that we have done nothing with the white push button up to this point. It's important that we don't push the push button as this overrides the scheduling. The purpose of the push button will be discussed in a moment. Let's look again at the first recorder that is currently in standby. When the current time of day does coincide with the scheduled record period, the recorder will autonomously switch from the standby state to the record state, as we see here. Notice the LED blinks rapidly at first to indicate a transition in operating states. Then the blink rate is reduced to save power and draw less attention when deployed. Likewise, the recorder will autonomously transition back to the standby state when the recording duration ends. Now let's discuss the function of the push button switch. The primary purpose of the push button is to manually stop a recording that's in progress. If the green LED on the front is blinking, as it is here, it means the Swift is actively writing audio data to a file on the SD card. If we were to remove the SD card or power off the recorder now, the audio file won't close properly and will become corrupted and unreadable. To avoid this, always use the push button to stop the recording and put the Swift into standby mode. When the Swift is in standby, the SD card can be safely ejected and the power can be turned off. Pushing the push button disables the scheduled record intervals, but reinserting the SD card or powering the SwiftOne off and then on again will reinitialize the schedule. To demonstrate, I'll turn the Swift back on and reinsert the SD card into the recorder. When I reinserted the SD card, the Swift once again checks the scheduling information and determines it should go into record mode again. So we just saw what happens when pressing the push button when the Swift is in record mode, but what happens if we push the button when the Swift is in standby mode, like the second recorder here? The answer is the recorder will immediately go into continuous record mode, recording for 24 hours a day until either the SD card is full, the batteries die, or the push button is pushed again. When you are ready to deploy the recorder, make sure it's powered on using the main on-off switch, and then secure the lid. When you are securing the lid, make sure the Lab of Ornithology logo is facing forward like shown here. Do not orient the lid like this or like this, because the lid will not seal correctly. Make sure it's oriented in this direction. Now, using the included Phillips head screwdriver, tighten the four screws to secure the lid in place. Simply hand tightening them is best. Do not over tighten, or the rubber gasket inside the lid may not seal effectively. Once you are at your field location, find a sturdy tree or post to strap the recorder to. Alternatively, you could use the 1/4-20 threaded hole in the metal base plate to attach the Swift to a tripod or similar. Make sure the strap is tight and secure. We recommend orienting the recorder with the microphone pointing down to keep debris and precipitation from falling directly on it. Secure the loose end of the strap so it won't blow around freely on a windy day and add unwanted noise to your recordings. You can choose to leave a voice memo, which is a short audio annotation stored separately from the other recordings. A voice memo is initiated by placing the keychain magnet between the record and standby LEDs. This is Swift recorder number 5 in the northeast corner of Sapsucker Woods. The time is currently 1:30 p.m. on November 15th, 2021. This acoustic recorder deployment is in support of a Cornell Lab of Ornithology Pacific Acoustic Monitoring Program. End the voice memo by using the keychain magnet again. You can now leave and let the recorder do its thing.